Welcome to part 1 of the timer series. Here you can learn WPF and C#. Let's look what we are going to have by the end of this video. So here we have our main timer, an optional subtimer which starts after the first one finishes, buttons to start or pause and stop the timer, optional sounds, presets for the main timer, presets for both timers, and finally it can hide to tray and come back from it on click. So let's create a new project. Type WPF in your search and select WPF app on C#. I will go with the .NET Framework version. Press the Next button. I will name the project Blue Timer and place solution and project in the same directory, but you can do as you want. You will still be able to follow along. As for framework, I will choose .NET Framework 3.5 for now because it supports Windows from XP to 10. Don't worry, I will upgrade in the next video. Click on Create. Now let's learn how to add an icon to the project and set it. First of all, I will create a folder called Resources for icons and other images if I have them. Apparently, you need an icon to edit. I already have one. If you don't, you can get the same from GitHub or any other. But this isn't a tutorial about creating icons, so get it on your own. So when you have it, right-click on your folder, hover over Add and select Existing Item. Here, you can navigate to your icon file. But if you want to keep your icon alone with your project, first copy your icon to the Resources folder. Then you need to click on Show all files. Here you can see your file which isn't in the project yet. Right-click it and select Include in project. Now we can set this file as an icon for our project. Double-click Properties of your project. Below the icon text you see a drop-down list. If you click on it, you can see your icon in the list. Select it. Now press F6 or Ctrl+B to build your project. Our icon should now be visible. Right-click on any open tab and select Open Containing Folder. Then go to Bin and Debug. Here you can see your icon. If you launch the program, you will see it in the program and taskbar as well. As you see, this icon uses different images for different sizes. So now you know how to add and set icons. It's time to practice XAML. First of all, let's change the title. Secondly, I'm going to make this window square, 500 by 500. Thirdly, because we are going to use tray, we'll need to track window state. So add state changed event. Also set resize mode to can minimize. Doing so will not let you change the size of the window, but will let you minimize and restore it. Just in case, let's give our window a recognizable name. In fact, we can even partially set the needed behavior right in XAML. We'll need to access window style for that. Then open the style tag and set target type to window. We will need only triggers, so open the style triggers tag and create a trigger inside of it. You can treat trigger as an if condition. We are going to check if property called window state equals minimized. Set property to window state and value to minimized. In C# you would then open curly braces, but in XAML you just open a setter tag nested in trigger. So if the condition is true, set the property show in taskbar to false. Again, you use property and value. So if I try to minimize the program, it will disappear from the taskbar. Let's see if it works. I'm going to minimize it and it will be gone. Yes, it works. But now we cannot restore it without tray. We are going to implement it later. Let's continue working in XAML. Our program is going to have two group boxes for presets. So let's define a style for them in Window Resources in advance. I will create one group box for preview. Create a style targeting group box. First, we'll give it a default margin of 1. Then we'll make it centered both horizontally and vertically. Of course, we will need controls for the time. Unfortunately, WPF doesn't provide with a numeric up-down or any other similar control out of the box. You can either use a third-party control or create your own. This time we'll do the latter. I'm going to simply use a style to customize our text boxes. Again, I'll put a text box for preview first. We'll limit the max text length to 2 characters by setting max length to 2. Not obligatory, but I'll make the font size bigger so that I could see the numbers from the comfort of my bed. Also set vertical content alignment to center. Now, because we need the functionality of numeric up-down, you have to create 3 event setters. One for preview text input, set its handler, we'll need it to allow only numbers. One for preview key down. We need it specifically to block the space key. And one for lost focus event. We will use it to make sure that the text box always has exactly 2 numbers, which aren't bigger than 59. Finally, I'm going to create a style for buttons to give them top margin. Again, a preview control. We are going to have about 40 buttons, so believe me, we saved us from a ton of work. At last, we can actually start designing. If you aren't blind yet, change the background to light golden rot yellow. There are going to be colons between text boxes, so I will create a style for text block in grid resources. They should be as big as text boxes. Also, let's make them horizontally and vertically centered. The program will have 3 columns, one for main timers presets, one for both timers presets, and one for the timer itself. All the extra space should go to the timer column, so set its width to a star. The first column will be a group box. Give it a header and a name, because it will be disabled while the timer is running. There are going to be 18 buttons for different presets, so it's wise to use a stack panel. Now let's create the first preset button. If there is something wrong with you, you can create a separate click event for all 36 buttons. Otherwise, let's make a universal click event, which will be common for all preset buttons. It will just parse the value that you will set in the tag property of each button. Now put your cursor on the line with the button without selecting any text. Then press Ctrl-C and Ctrl-V for quick copy-paste of the current line. We only need to change the text and the tag properties. I'll duplicate it 4 times to make seconds-only presets. I recommend you to just repeat after me for now. Only when you understand how the parse in C# will work should you try to change these presets. Now let's make a preset for 1 minute. Pay attention to the changes in tag. So you set minutes before the dot, while seconds after the dot. It's just as easy to use both minutes and seconds. I'll make 10 more presets. By now you should understand how to set your own values for main timer presets. The name isn't parsed, but keep it relevant, not to be confused yourself. We are done with the main timer presets. Now create a group box for subtimer presets with the stack panel inside of it.
I'm going to place this group box in the second column, so set grid column to 1. I will give it a name because we will enable and disable the whole group box along with all buttons inside of it from code. Don't forget to give it a relevant header. I will type subtimer presets. And we finally nest a stack panel inside of this group box.
We are going to use the same click event, but tags are going to be a bit different, so it's quicker to just create a new button and duplicate it. This time minutes for the main timer go before the plus character, while minutes for the subtimer follow the plus character. Now all our presets are ready and we can start designing the timer in the third column. The timer half is going to be in a grid divided by 4 rows. The main timer will be also in a grid with 5 columns for text boxes and columns between them. Text boxes will occupy as much width as possible, while columns will have the minimum. All text boxes and columns will look the same, but give text boxes names because we'll access them from code, each containing 2 zeros on start.
Now we are going to create a text block. Set the grid column to 1. Text blocks will not need names. Their only text will be a colon. Then we can just duplicate these two controls. Just change the grid column property and give a unique name to the text box. And finally, the last text box. Again, just put it in grid column 4 and change the name to tb_seconds.
The grid for subtimer will look similar, but not exactly. First of all, this grid's isEnabled property will be bound to a checkbox, which will be responsible for enabling or disabling the subtimer. So, time for little binding practice. Because we bind not to C# properties, but to another controls property, we need to specify element name of binding. And path is the property that you want to bind to. Now, this grid will have only 4 columns, because the subtimer won't have hours for now. Instead of a text box for hours and the first column, we will put a text block saying subtimer.
Change the name of the minutes text box. I'm going to just add the word sub after the underscore. I will do the same for the second text box. Let's decrease the font size of the text block saying subtimer. Also, don't forget to update grid column property of controls.
In the next row, we are going to create buttons for starting or pausing and stopping the timer.
We will use a grid to place those two buttons in 2 equal columns. This grid is going to be in the second row, so set grid row to 1. Let's give it a 10 pixel margin on top and bottom. In grid column definitions, place 2 column definitions. Both of them will have a star width, so they will occupy all available space.
The button to start or pause will be the same. By the way, if you want to make comments in XAML, type left angle bracket exclamation 2 dashes your comment and close it with 2 dashes and right angle bracket. In the first column, I'm going to create a button for starting and pausing. In the second column, I'm going to make a button for stopping.
Change the comment, update grid column, set the name to button underscore stop. Let's give it a tooltip, because it's going to have non-textual content. Create a new click event. Press F12 to generate it and then return. When we finish, the visibility will be set to hidden by default. Finally, remove the inline content.
I want to place a black square inside this button. So I'll add an image to project. You can get it from the repository on GitHub. Now let's create an image control inside this button. The last row will contain sounds and checkboxes. Let's use a stack panel. In the first row, we are going to have a checkbox to enable or disable sound.
Give it a name because we are going to check its isChecked property from code. Its content does not matter, so type whatever you want. I will give it a 0 margin in case we add a default margin later. By default, the checkbox will be checked, so we can hear sound notifications without efforts.
Below it, we will use a grid to keep 5 radio button controls organized. Each radio button will need a name because we'll access it in C#. And finally, at the end, we are going to put a checkbox to say whether the subtimer should be enabled or not. Make sure you give it a name because we bound our subtimer's grid to this control. By the way, let's check if the binding works. So it does. That means that we are done with XAML and binding.
In the next tutorial, we are going to program backend using C# code.